350 years ago, a great battle was fought in the heart of Britain. A battle that would shake the British monarchy to its core.
It would challenge forever the belief that the king had a God-given right to rule without the consent of his people.
Together with my historian son, Dan, I'll be revealing how the ferocious clash that took place here revolutionized the way Britain was governed.
On one side, the soldiers of the king. On the other, men fighting for Parliament. This was the first British army where talent counted for more than breeding. I'll be following the story of these ordinary men who were shaped into a new kind of fighting force.
Our officers are on the field because they are good soldiers, not because they have been placed there by a right of birth.
The man who fights for his conscience is better than a man who fights for any king.
These quiet English fields are seen by many as the birthplace of British democracy. But it was a birth that was drenched in blood. Bloodshed right here in 1645 on the battlefield of Naseby. In 1629, England was ruled by an uneasy alliance between the King and Parliament. But the alliance was reaching breaking point. At the heart of the problem was a conflict about how much control Parliament could or should have over the monarch. The King, Charles I, a neat, elegant man, believed he had been appointed by God to rule as he saw fit, that he had the divine right of kings. Charles had been at loggerheads with the members of Parliament for years. The Puritans amongst them disliked his marriage to a French Catholic and his fondness for lavish religious ritual. Others criticized his choice of political advisors and his involvement in expensive wars in Europe. By 1629, Charles was so sick of Parliament arguing with him that he shut it down and ruled alone. But this left Charles with a problem. The king needed MPs to vote him the right to collect key taxes. Without Parliament, Charles had to find other ways to get money out of his subjects.
Loopholes were found in ancient tax laws to squeeze as much cash out of the people as possible. Taxpayers were outraged at this abuse and the sidelining of their parliament. Many regarded Charles as a tyrant.
We had nothing. We were being bled dry.
He made demands for money that were unreasonable.
He believed only in his divine right to rule. And then he ignored the will of Parliament.
Charles ruled on his own for 11 years. But in 1640, he found himself in need of serious money to finance a war. Desperate for more cash, he swallowed his pride and turned to the only people who could vote him the money he needed.
Parliament. The MPs returned to London, and amongst them was one who would rise from obscurity to become the king's most powerful enemy, Oliver Cromwell.
Oliver Cromwell was stocky, ruddy-faced, and famously, he had warts. He was hard-working Puritan gentry.
He called himself a gentleman. He doesn't look like a gentleman, doesn't sound like a gentleman. He's a farmer. Nothing elegant about him.
He may only have been a farmer, but now Cromwell and his fellow MPs had the king in their power. They would give him the money he wanted, but only if he agreed to radical reforms.
At first, Charles accepted their demands, but his anger was growing with these upstart MPs. Then they insisted on a veto over his choice of political advisors. This was a drastic challenge to his authority.
And the king refused to give in. Over the next 6 months, the crisis deepened. No political compromise could be found, and it seemed increasingly likely that the power struggle would erupt into a civil war.
On Monday, the 22nd of August, 1642, King Charles raised the royal standard. This was a call to arms for his supporters. The King of England had declared war on his Parliament.
As both sides started to raise their armies, difficult decisions had to be made up and down the country. Which side would people support? Should they back the king and join his cavaliers, or support Parliament and become known as a roundhead?
These decisions would set brother against brother and friend against friend. Yeah. Within weeks, the country was thrown into brutal conflict. Fire.
When the Civil War began, both sides thought one great battle would decide it, but it didn't. It went on and on. There was the Battle of Edge Hill, the Battle of Turnham Green, the Battle of Hopton Heath, Bristol Field, Sawton Down, Nantwich, Admalton Moor, Lansdowne Hill, Marston Moor, and many others.
The problem was that both sides managed to maintain armies strong enough to threaten each other, but not to deal out the killer blow. So the Civil War dragged on.
2 years into the conflict, the situation was bleak.
44. I would say it was definitely one of the darkest periods of the war.
England was in a terrible state.
Families fighting families, brothers fighting brothers.
Englishmen could do this to one another. The country was weary.
In fact, after 2 years of warfare, there was still no clear victor. The war had divided the country in half, literally. The Royalists had their capital here in Oxford and controlled the Midlands, the southwest, and Wales. Parliament had its capital here in London and controlled the southeast, East Anglia, and the north. Something had to happen to break this stalemate. And in the autumn of 1644, it looked as if that moment had come.
The crucial encounter took place near the Berkshire town of Newbury. Here, Parliament was handed a golden opportunity to inflict a crushing defeat on the king once and for all. It ordered three of its armies to join together to confront the Royalists. The parliamentarians would have Charles totally outnumbered. At last, an end to the Civil War was in sight.
On the evening of the 26th of October, 1644, the two sides met face to face just north of Newbury, not far from this castle at Donnington. The castle was held by the Royalists, commanded by the king in person. Here's the castle here. The Royalists also held strong defensive positions at Shaw House and Speen Hill, with a total of 9,000 cavalry and infantry. The parliamentarians were massed over here to the east, up on Clay Hill. They had the king powerfully outnumbered, 19,000 men to the king's 9,000, an advantage of more than 2-1. It was the greatest numerical advantage parliamentarians had enjoyed since the Civil War began.
The Royalists stationed here around Shaw House were told to strengthen their defences and dig in. 400 musketeers were placed in a dry moat around the outside of the house, another 400 in the gardens there. They may have been outnumbered 2-1, but they'd been on a winning streak recently and they are feeling pretty confident.
We'd won the last battle. We had three good positions. We were dug in at Shaw House, we had the castle, and all right, we were outnumbered, but we had one thing, we weren't afraid.
Seeing that the Royalists held strong defensive positions, The parliamentarians up here on Clay Hill came up with a bold idea. They would exploit their advantage in numbers by splitting their forces and by attacking the royalists from front and rear simultaneously. Once night fell, two-thirds of the parliamentarian army would march off through the dark in a great arc, which would take them round behind Donnington Castle and put them here, in the rear of the royalist line. Once in position, they would fire a cannon as a signal to those over here on the east side to start a simultaneous attack on this sector around Shawhuz. It was an ambitious and daring plan, and among the parliamentarian commanders in the outflanking party was Oliver Cromwell, now a lieutenant general in the parliamentarian forces.
Before the war, Cromwell had never fought in a battle, but after 2 years of conflict, he'd proved himself a gifted cavalry officer. As night fell, Cromwell, his cavalry, and thousands more parliamentarian soldiers set off on the long march.
When the troops marched off that night, half of them were carrying their muskets, weighing about half a stone, and the other half were carrying these very cumbersome, very long spears called pikes. They were about 16 to 18 foot long. Given that I'm about 6'6", therefore about a foot taller than the average infantryman in the Civil War, I'm finding it pretty difficult to use. I don't know how they would have found it. I've been marching for over an hour tonight, but I probably managed only a pretty measly 3 miles, which is a fraction of what they had to do. The interesting thing about these is that night marches must always have been tricky for GPS and infrared night sights and stuff. But with these, it's absolutely lethal. I mean, I've hit trees about 4 times. I've piled it into the ground several times, almost killing myself, let alone the guys behind me. Just the thought of a whole army of people walking down the road with these is absolutely terrifying. My shoulder and neck are really stiff, really painful, and I can see why they risked such punishment by sawing the bottom 2 or 3 feet off their pikes.
The parliamentarian soldiers marched through most of the night and into the following day.
By early afternoon the next day, the parliamentarians' great encircling movement was complete. They had the king surrounded, and at 3 o'clock, the commander of the troops over on this side gave the order for his infantry to attack and for a cannon to be fired as a signal to their comrades over here. The Battle of Newbury had started.
As soon as they made their move, those parliamentarians who just marched through the night came under a hail of cannon fire. But they pushed on, and soon infantry was fighting infantry.
Oh!
powerless, put up an impressive defense. The parliamentarians hadn't expected it to be this difficult. The royalists should have been on the point of collapse. After all, they were outnumbered and threatened from two sides. But they weren't collapsing. Something was going wrong.
The parliamentarians' plan had relied on a coordinated attack on two fronts. But whilst the parliamentarians who'd marched round here were in the thick of it, the rest of their army over here on the east had still not made a move. It was only after an hour of fighting that this lot finally received the command to attack. The bold plan to trap the king in the simultaneous two-pronged assault had failed.
Soon it was too dark for anyone to see, and the battle simply stopped.
What had seemed a golden opportunity for Parliament had been thrown away. It was said their plan for a two-pronged attack failed because the cannon signal hadn't been heard over on the second front. That's possible. But there was a strong suspicion among some parliamentarians, Cromwell included, that the high command simply wasn't up to the job. And in view of what happened later that same night, he may well have been right.
The royalists had fought ferociously to hold off the parliamentarians, but they knew they weren't up to another day's fighting. So that night, the entire royalist army quit Newbury and headed off on the road to Oxford. Thousands of them would have crossed this small bridge in the village of Donnington. It was an obvious line of retreat, but no parliamentarians blocked their path. There was nothing to stop the royalists escaping.
We got the order to withdraw, and they let us walk away.
They gave us no trouble, much to my amazement.
The next day, Cromwell was desperate to give chase, but to his fury, his request for troops was refused. Newbury had been a humiliating fiasco. Cromwell blamed it on vacillating and incompetent leadership.
He was furious that such a perfect chance to end this destructive war had been squandered. Cromwell was now convinced that if Parliament was to win the war, its army needed new commanders and a radical overhaul. So he headed to Westminster to make this happen. Throughout the rest of the winter, Cromwell worked to push two new laws through Parliament. These laws would revolutionize the parliamentarian forces. MPs passed one bill to create the country's first ever national army.
Out would go the loose network of local militias, and in would come a new force, centrally administered, a slick, coordinated organization. The second bill removed all members of the Commons and the Lords from military command. Leadership would now be based on ability, not class. The lessons of Newbury had been learned. The so-called New Model Army was born.
Soon, equipment, uniforms, and weapons were pouring in. There was a big recruitment drive, too.
Shoulder your pikes!
Both old and new soldiers were freshly equipped.
March on!
There were thousands of new muskets, pikes, saddles, and swords. And for the first time, a uniform coat, the same for all the infantry. To keep costs down, they went for the cheapest dye, red. The new model army were the first red coats. Discipline was very strict. There was to be no swearing, no excess drinking, and no plundering. Any breach of the rules would be dealt with severely.
Should you blaspheme, then you will have a red-hot spike thrust through your tongue. And there is also if you were to call a fellow parliamentarian a roundhead, then you will be cashiered instantly upon the spot.
We are a professional fighting army. The royalists, those rogues, are ill-disciplined. We will beat them in battle with discipline.
In the new model army, only two things counted if you wanted to get to the top. One was proven ability as a soldier, and the other, commitment to Parliament's cause. Social standing didn't really matter. For the first time, ordinary men could become senior officers. One man, Thomas Pride, had been a drayman before the war. Another, John Hewson, had been a cobbler. And yet both these two were now lieutenant colonels in the new model army.
I myself am just a man of the land, a farmer. My men are proud of me, and I am proud of them, and I am proud to lead them.
Oliver Cromwell was a driving force in designing the new army. Early in the war, he had created an outstanding regiment of horsemen known as the Ironsides. They were now the core of the new model cavalry, and Cromwell made sure that the key principles of training and discipline that made the Ironsides so formidable were now applied to the entire new model army. Cromwell made his horsemen train relentlessly to perfect the skills of disciplined riding and effective use of weapons. Skills still practiced for competitions by the army today.
Yeah, slice that one in two, I reckon. I think I got some melon juice.
Almost half and half.
The army riders have been doing this for years. We've only got one day.
What about us? What are we going to be able to do by the end of today?
Right, today what I'm going to get you to do is we're going to start with a broom handle, as we do with everyone that's starting off, and we're going to put you on motorbikes because you don't ride. So we're going to put you on motorbikes, riders pillion, and we're going to get you attacking the target.
And then walk forward, simulation of the being on the bike.
The momentum of the bike is going to take you forward, and so you're going to come through into the melon there and stop.
That's the easy bit.
That's the easy bit. Now we must see what we're doing when we get on the bike.
It was time to trade our broom handles for the real thing.
Okay, there you go, Peter.
Yep.
Dan.
Thank you.
Take your swords.
It's a sharp sword, this.
It's a very sharp sword. That's why we have to be very careful, which is why we've gone from the broom handles to start with. We don't want to be damaging the guys.
Absolutely. You're telling me. I'm feeling very sorry for those melons, particularly mine.
Whatever. Jolly good. Okay, well then, let me take that off you. Let me take that sword off you, Peter.
Ooh, right.
And helmet.
Well.
How did you find that?
Good. It's low speeds, it's all right. But then as soon as the speed comes up anywhere near a horse, that target just flashes by. It's amazing. I don't know how you can hit it.
It becomes second nature. Once you're up there, you just get on there and go straight in for you.
Just training day after day. Yes. So you get the technical side sorted. So in the battle, you've got to do is worry about getting up for it and getting aggressive.
Right. Yeah. And once again, presumably it's momentum that counts again. As long as you get the aim right, you're going to make a real mess of the person you hit. If
you just
hold that sword in the right place.
Yes, you are. And it's a very, very effective weapon.
Their skills. Their commanders were determined that training and discipline would make the new model into a crack force that would crush their skills. Their commanders were determined that training and discipline would make the new model into a crack force that would crush the royalists.
But as the new model army began to take shape, there was one notable absentee, Oliver Cromwell himself. The very law that Cromwell had promoted to improve the professionalism of the army, the one that blocked MPs from holding command, of course, excluded him too from holding command. The driving force behind this military revolution had to sit and watch from the sidelines.
I thought it was very foolish. I mean, Cromwell was a man amongst men. We believed in him. I mean, he had proven himself so many times on and off the field. It was like we'd thrown away one of our greatest strengths.
Parliament appointed Sir Thomas Fairfax as overall commander of the new army. Fairfax was a battle-hardened soldier, respected by his friends and enemies alike.
He took to the job with great energy, just as well, because with the arrival of spring, the start of the new campaigning season was now very close.
Charles had spent the winter in Oxford. The city had been transformed since becoming the royalist capital.
Teaching work at the university almost ground to a halt. This beautiful cloister was the royalist gunpowder store. Imagine, one small mistake with a match and the whole thing would have been blown to smithereens. Students who had been learning their Plato and their Aristotle now used these quads as military training grounds.
As winter turned to spring, King Charles must have been aware that Parliament was creating a new army. But he didn't believe that this demanded any major changes on his side, except one. He appointed his nephew, Prince Rupert, as Lieutenant General in charge of all his forces in England.
Prince Rupert is a fearsome man of immense personal courage. I felt that with Prince Rupert in overall command, the next season's fighting would be a very successful one.
The new commander was not the only thing the royalists felt they had in their favour. Many also had a very low opinion of Parliament's so-called new model army.
I heard that one officer was nothing more than a brewer's drayman. Another shoemaker. With officers like these, I felt very confident. We didn't think we had any reason to feel scared.
The parliamentarian commander Fairfax was confident too. By the end of April, the new model army was far better drilled, equipped and organised than the army that had been humiliated at Newbury. Now Fairfax wanted just one thing, to find and defeat the king. By early May, Charles and the Royalists were also on the march, heading north. Everyone was in buoyant mood. The king himself wrote to his wife that things had never looked so good. Against the advice of his new commander, Prince Rupert, he divided his army. He'd sent off 3,000 cavalry to the West Country. Where he believed the new model army were heading. And he and Prince Rupert had taken the rest of his army north to relieve garrisons and gather reinforcements. Little did he know, Charles was within days of the battle that would decide his fate. Charles, Rupert, and the Royalist army arrived here in the town of Market Harborough in June 1645. At this stage, they had no clear idea where the new model army was. In fact, Fairfax and his roundheads were hard on their heels. They were just 15 miles away and in very good cheer. That same morning, they'd had some excellent news.
6 a.m., the men of the new model army were preparing for the day ahead. saddling their horses and packing up their kit when they saw Oliver Cromwell galloping into camp. The news spread fast. Parliament must have realised the mistake it made in excluding one of its most talented and popular officers.
Cromwell was now in charge of the new model cavalry, with the rank of Lieutenant General of Horse. The men greeted his arrival with a huge cheer.
That was a beautiful sight. We believe now we have God on our side with a general, and we must surely win.
The new model army was spoiling for a fight. Soon, word reached the royalists that the enemy was close by.
The moment he received the news, Charles called a council of war here in Market Harborough. And the outcome? Rather than march on north, they would turn around and confront the parliamentarians. Some, like Prince Rupert, had urged caution. But Charles was convinced that he had an army of veterans who could see off the untested new model army. In the next 24 hours, the most decisive battle of this protracted civil war would be played out. And the battlefield, a hilly area between Market Harborough and the village of Naseby, 6 miles to the southwest. Early on the morning of Saturday, the 14th of June, 1645, at 6 a.m., the Royalists moved south out of Market Harborough and formed a battle line along that high ground about 3 miles away over there. This is that ridge just here. The King and Prince Rupert positioned their forces all the way along that ridge. Now, this piece of high ground here, where I'm standing now, is where Cromwell and Fairfax rode up to look at the lie of the land. They'd moved their new model army up here, just slightly north of the village of Naseby, which is just off down there. They could clearly see the Royalists fanning out on that other ridge over there, so they were in no doubt the King and his men wanted to do battle. But there was one snag. The trouble was, the new model army's position was too good and actually made a battle less likely. The slope in front of them was so steep it'd be suicide for enemy cavalry to charge up it. Fine for defence, but not if you wanted to provoke an attack. And that was exactly what Cromwell wanted to do. So he said to Fairfax, "I beseech you, draw back to yonder hill, which will encourage the enemy to charge us." And so they agreed to shunt their entire battle line sideways to some more gentle ground to the west. The Royalists followed the lead, also eager to bring the conflict to a head.
Both sides now began to assemble on either side of a valley that was to become the battlefield of Naseby.
By 10 a.m., the two armies had moved to their new positions. The Royalists all along that slope over there, the Parliamentarians up there. That Royalist ridge over there is just here. The two sides were on opposite slopes, facing each other with 800 meters of flat ground between them. The two battle lines were about a mile wide from end to end. Estimates vary, but the King had roughly 4,500 infantry in three lines in the center. The King himself, dressed in full plate armor, was back here with his reserves in the third line. On the flanks, the Royalist cavalry, around 10,000 Royalists altogether. Against them, around 13,500 men of the new model army. Their cavalry were also split into two wings. Their right wing was commanded by Oliver Cromwell. In the centre, here, were the infantry. Neither side had a great battle plan. Both thought they would win in a straight contest, a head-on clash. It was not strategy, but strength, courage and discipline that would decide the battle.
The new model infantrymen began to form up here on this slope. But then came an order from Fairfax. They were to move back over the crest of this hill so that the Royalist infantry over there wouldn't be able to see them. This may have been to disguise their strength and their numbers, but it also meant that any raw recruits amongst them wouldn't be intimidated by the terrifying sight of their enemy.
Just before the battle began, Cromwell spotted an opportunity. In those days, all this was open land, except for a long hedgerow here. Cromwell saw that these hedges could provide perfect cover, so he sent a detachment of dragoons, soldiers who travelled on horseback but fought on foot, led by Colonel Oakey, up behind the hedges to a spot right up here, just yards away from where Prince Rupert's horsemen were preparing to advance.
We galloped there, which took the edge off my nerve, and we positioned ourselves as we were told.
Oakey's men rode up here, dismounted, and then took cover behind these hedges. From this vantage point, they could see the Royalist cavalry with Prince Rupert himself at its head, just through there, and they were preparing for a charge. The dragoons loaded their weapons, and through the hedge they unleashed a hail of musket fire.
Fire from the hedges!
The shot came from nowhere, and the horses just went. We had no choice. Some of our men were hit, but we had to keep moving. The rebels were firing from behind hedges.
The Battle of Naseby had begun.
Startled by the surprise attack, 2,500 horses of the Royalist cavalry charged in waves, three men deep, swords drawn. The left wing of the new model cavalry facing them moved forward to meet them.
Seemed to move at once. Sounded like thunder. Swords drawn, charging off.
Remember details, you just keep at it.
The parliamentarian cavalry did well in the initial clash, but as reserves piled in on both sides, the Royalists got the upper hand.
We're just too good for them. Our swordplay, everything, just too strong. Rebels, they just turned and they fled.
They turned and ran like cowards, and we chased them.
Most of the new model horsemen were chased off this battlefield by the prince's cavalry. In fact, some of them kept going and didn't stop till they reached Northampton, 15 miles away. The Royalist cavalry galloped off in pursuit until they discovered the Roundhead baggage train. Unable to resist the temptation, many of them didn't return to the battle, but got stuck in a tussle for booty.
Our charge was a complete success. It was an exhilarating time. And then to be faced with all that plunder. Well, I defy any man to ignore it.
The cavalry charge over there was a disaster for the parliamentarians. Half their supposedly disciplined force of horsemen had disappeared from the field altogether. And by now, the Royalist infantry had begun their advance, straight up here. they tramped forward in tight formation, five regiments in a line half a mile wide.
We got the order to advance, and the drum sounded, and we began to march to the beat. Muskets loaded, ready to fire.
Charge your pike!
We moved up the hill. We still couldn't see them.
We knew they were there. We knew they weren't far away, but we didn't know what we were going to walk into.
These men were hardened veterans, but they would have had dry mouths and pounding hearts. It must have been incredibly unnerving, knowing the new model army was ready and waiting, but out of sight, just over the brow of the hill.
We were just behind a hill, which meant that the Royalists could not see us, but it also meant that we could not see the Royalists. And we were all of us nervous, old hands and new recruits alike.
Parliamentarians moved to the crest of the hill, into full view of the advancing Royalists.
They came into view over the slope and they were so close, we had no idea they were that close.
I looked down and there was the enemy, the line of the enemy, closer than I had ever imagined.
Both sides fired. Up to half of the new model infantry were new recruits. And when they found themselves face to face with the Royalists, much of what they'd learnt in training seemed to melt away. Many failed to grip their muskets tightly enough. When they fired, the shot passed over the head of the Royalists.
After the initial round of fire, everything seemed to go silent for a moment. But it seemed like forever.
You lived those minutes like days, but I hadn't been it.
I thought by God's hand this day was my last. But somehow, by His grace, I was still standing.
With the gap between the two sides fast closing, there was no time for any of that cumbersome reloading of muskets, and so they fought it out hand to hand. The musketeers grabbed their weapons by the barrels and used the butts to club people to the ground.
You went straight in there, turn your musket round and crack a few skulls.
The pikemen threw away their long pikes and lashed out with their swords instead.
There was a great roar from both sides, and I began to run without thinking. Chaos. A bloody mess.
Blood. Mud. Screaming. Enough to turn a heathen to God, that's for sure.
Yeah.
after half an hour of this furious infantry battle, so successful was the Royalist pressure that parts of the Parliamentarian line were fragmenting. Fairfax's regiment here was still standing its ground, but to its left, men were running for their lives. The fiercest battle of all was fought by Skippon's regiment here. They fought valiantly, but eventually they were pressed back. Despite its new commanders, recruits, and training, the new model army's first line looked close to collapse.
Half our cavalry had left the field. Lord knows where they went. And our infantry were being hard pressed. It seemed to me that we were breaking.
As the Parliamentarian infantry fought for survival in the centre over there, Oliver Cromwell and the rest of the Parliamentarian cavalry were right here where I'm standing, looking on helplessly. This is where Cromwell was, over here on Parliament's right wing. Cromwell would have liked to come to the rescue of the infantry to his left over here, but he now had to deal with a bigger threat. He and his horsemen had to face the rest of the King's cavalry, about to attack him from this slope over here. Prince Rupert's first cavalry charge over on the other side had destroyed the Parliamentarian left. Now Parliament's centre was being beaten back as well. So if Cromwell failed to fight off the King's cavalry over here on the right, the Battle of Naseby would be as good as lost. The Royalist horsemen started to charge. Cromwell gave the order for his men to charge to meet them. The fate of Parliament's army now depended on Cromwell and his Ironsides. Cavalry battle that followed was savage. The Royalist horsemen fought hard, but eventually the new model army's discipline and training began to pay off.
We rode in at their line and took them straight. That was hard, that was hand to hand. My men held their line, my men went through their line, and this time, that were them Royalists that turned and fled.
For the first time in the battle, Parliament had the edge. Maybe the King could have regained the advantage now. If he had introduced his reserve, they might have overpowered the Ironsides and won the day. But he did not. Soon the Royalist cavalry were fleeing back over the hill there. Suddenly it was Cromwell and the new model army who had the golden opportunity. As the Royalist cavalry turned and galloped off in utter confusion, Cromwell allowed only part of his force to chase them away. With the cool judgment that Prince Rupert had lacked, Cromwell held back most of his cavalry, wheeled them to the left, and fell upon the Royalist infantry in the center.
We turned our men a horse and we went back at their infantry. That was exciting. That was exhilarating. We were proud. And it seemed then that with God on our side, we would surely have victory.
Run, you dog!
Cromwell's cavalry had turned the battle in Parliament's favour. Now, the Royalist infantry were at their mercy.
What really went wrong for us was the Roundhead cavalry. We were in no shape to defend ourselves.
There's nothing you can do against the horse. They're kicking and slashing through us with swords, and men were just falling like flies.
To make matters worse, the parliamentarian infantry, who had seemed to be on the brink of collapse, were now being strengthened. Some of these reinforcements were from the reserves. Others were men who had fled from the battle, but were now being sent back into the fray by their commanders. Those men whose firing had started the whole battle, Colonel Oakey's dragoons, were so inspired by what they were seeing that they came out from behind the hedges and charged.
Dragoons, well, we had never done cavalry charges before. It was all fired up. We all wanted to be part of it. And so we did. We rode and we fought.
And it wasn't long before the combined parliamentarian pressure of the reinvigorated infantry in the centre, Cromwell's rampaging horsemen over here on the right, and the daredevil dragoons coming in on the left, began to break the royalist line and turn the king's infantry regiments into flight. All except one, just here.
Not all regiments broke. One regiment stood. Bluecoats. They were there at the storming of Bolton and Liverpool. Relief at York. They were notorious.
There was only the Bluecoats left. One regiment against the whole rebel army.
War! March!
Troops surrendered or fled, the Bluecoats stood firm. An eyewitness said they were like a wall of brass, thrusting their pikes at attacking horses and firing volley after volley. The new model cavalry charged once and then again, but to no avail. The Bluecoats held their ground. Odds were massively against them, but the Bluecoats refused to surrender. More and more new model army troops were set upon them with sword, pike, and musket butt. Cavalry hammered them from front and rear.
We could see them, and they were standing strong, and they held on, and they held on, and they were standing wave upon wave of attack.
I knew they couldn't last forever, but as they held on and held on, I began to think that they might.
But the new model army relentlessly pursued its assault, pouring fire into the ranks of Blue.
Faced with overwhelming force, the Bluecoats finally broke, and they were cut to pieces.
I stood and watched them all. Being slaughtered. And I cried.
The Royalists were in retreat. But then Charles, who seems to have been strangely inert throughout the battle, had a sudden burst of zeal.
Even though he must have known the battle was now certainly lost, surveying the scene here before him, Charles tried to rally men for one final cavalry charge against the pursuing enemy. But someone described by accounts of the time as a person of quality seized the king's bridle, swore at him, and exclaimed, "Would you go upon your death?" Charles, always swayed by the last person to speak to him, heeded the warning and fled.
The king may have escaped, but his men weren't so lucky. A group of them thought they were following the main road, but when they got into this churchyard, they realized it was a dead end. When the Roundheads caught up with them, there was carnage. This field is still known today as Slaughterford Field. But the truth is, wherever the Royalists ended up, they fared little better. Thousands were taken prisoner. The Royalist army was cut down at its knees, and with it went the Royalist cause.
Naseby was not the last battle of the Civil War, but it was the beginning of the end. The destruction of Charles's infantry on this battlefield was decisive. The king would never lead such an experienced army again.
Don't know what the future holds. I never thought we'd be defeated like this. What do they want, a country without a king? What would that be like?
I hope the king sees reason now. He listens to the will of Parliament. That is my hope. But I think it might be too late for that.
The king did not make peace with Parliament. He tried to fight on, but it was futile.
Within a year, Parliament had triumphed and Charles was a prisoner. In 1649, he was tried for treason here in Westminster Hall, condemned to death and beheaded. The country became a republic with Oliver Cromwell as its head of state. The monarchy was eventually restored, but the Civil War had changed Britain forever. Parliament had entrenched itself at the heart of the Constitution. King Charles I had aimed at absolute power. After Naseby, no other British monarch would dare do that again.
There's a reconstruction of the Battle of Naseby happening this weekend at Audley End House in Essex. You can go there and watch cavalrymen, pikemen and musketeers of the Civil War fighting it out all over again. For information about this or any of the other events going on around the country, or to ask me a question about any of the programmes in this series, log on to bbc.co.uk/history. In the next programme, we follow the story of a notorious battle that has more violent echoes than any other battle in the history of the British Isles. Three centuries ago, a river in the heart of Ireland ran red with blood. The battle that played out on the riverbanks was the last ever between two rival kings of Britain. It would determine the fate of the people of Ireland to this day. The year was 1690, and it was the Battle of the Boyne.
Peter and Dan Snow give full details of the decisive British battles featured in the series in this illustrated BBC book.